So welcome, everybody. In the first part of the panel, there will be Yoni van den Ede and I have to confirm the pronunciation of that title. So I'll introduce the first speaker first. OOOOO is a trans-universal constellation that initiates, mediates, and facilitates, curates, and appropriates projects, abducing thought, reflection, and praxis on relevant issues. OOOOO is hosted by Marta van Dessel, an activist and performer who creates interfaces, devices, and protocols to instigate our urban and institutional hardware and software. She engages in the administrative, cultural, socio-political dimension of personal and collective identities. By triggering intersubjective alliances, she constructs the self and other to the commons, co-authorship, and the redistribution into the public domain.
I was also looking for a tripod because to hold a microphone and a paper. I don't know whether we have a tripod. Yeah, but it's in use. Okay, and then this, because we had no, maybe you can distribute this one around. So I'm very glad to be here in this challenging event. And we come as OOO. And actually, because we are in this TV setup with bright lights and cameras, it's actually easier to introduce OOO. Because normally, as in the introduction, it said like, I'm the host. And it seems now I'm the TV host of OOO, which is a constellation. And as mentioned, I create interfaces, devices, hardware, and protocols to instigate our institutional environment. And examples are we make instruments, we make walks, we make expositions, we make radio shows, we contribute to code or for this interface project from QO, initiated by QO2. We had like a laboratory, like with a DIY biochemical laboratory to make piezoelectric crystals. So I mostly engage, I'm almost repeating my own biography too, in administrative, cultural, and political dimensions of personal and collective identities. And we are in durational ecologies with, for example, the Future Farmers, which is an artist collective based in the US, but also Anarchia Server, which is a feminist autonomous server based in the, I'm not going to say where the data center is, and Rooftop Tiger and many others. And OOO is also such a body, or even this embodied. So what we do, we ask questions. And in these questions, so maybe a little, yeah, a little help. Yeah. And this is the collective disembodied body to have like technical adjustments. So in these questions, we ask, we try to feed communality. So the question is what we have in common, but we don't try to streamline ideas. They aren't discursive projects. It can be. it could be that it's. But I'm going to move anyhow. So, so they aren't discursive projects. It could be that we are just talking, but mostly they are practice based. And I tend to use like praxis because like it has like an intersection of theory and praxis. And we confront ourselves with what we are doing, like how to redistribute that into the public domain, but also to ask questions about co-authorship and the commons. And it could be by disclosing documentation, or like Melissa said, like just to occupy state frequencies, or to build open hardware, to be beta testers of other people who disclose their documentation online. And in a biological process, in biomatter and wetware, it's always more poetic. So let's call it reverse osmosis, but I hope there is no biologist here. And OOO is feminist, you know. We are like, we trigger like emancipative processes, and because we feel that we have to decolonize our technologies. They are developed by white, racist, heteronormative, privileged men. Before it would be called maybe the clerus, or the bourgeoisie, or the nations. So I will, during, because we don't have a black screen, during the presentation, I will hand out some things which can also somehow trigger this emancipative process. So here we are in a TV set. Almost all nations had like television, and they had like this, it was a powerful tool to propagate ideologies, the insistence of one point of view and make people believe. And of course, that got privatized, and more commercial channels appeared. And commercial channels, that means like they show what sells the best, and as the state, they also censor and control, and this mirror of representation. We have to enter the television. So document, represent, document, represent. We believe in diffraction as in queer nature of performativity. Not a mirror, but a diffraction. And by an obstacle, we see the properties of the relation. Anyway, technology got democratized, and any amateur could buy like a cassette, a video camera. We earn money for that. And in that time, OOO was like VJing. So we also shifted from the analog to the digital. And we were processing and coding and using softwares. But at that time, quite a lot of cracks, like pirate copies, extended school licenses, and trying out freeware. And started also a little bit to experiment with open source software and hardware. And we can make TV, and we can make music, but we felt that there was like more than an urgency than creating more like visual input, because like, as you said, the electromagnetic spectrum is wide, and if you only concentrate on our eyes, we all we exclude a lot, because it's theta hertz, it's very 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 high frequencies. So in our modern global technology, it developed, and even television had like peer-to-peer protocols, so we can share. We can distribute, we can transmit. And we know most of the popular entertainment channels. I'm not going to advertise them. Their principle is eat as much as you can. You don't own, you listen, you watch. And we know that there is no limitation to consumption. And even currently we are shifting in the Aussie model, where providers, the one who gives you the internet, even become channels. So technology is biased, but we can also become a channel and resist these walled gardens. We share networks and disks and servers, sometimes through very private VPN, through private tunnels. But that's also a little bit, it's credential based, you know. Then we have to see who trusts who. And then in that system, we are actually like confirming the meritocracy. Like who merits to be inside of that small-circled environment. Of course, that small-circled environment also have to maintain these autonomous infrastructures, the service with the services, if we don't want to go for the 2, 3, 4, 5 we know. So there is like somehow gatekeeping, and maybe archive.org is a good example because there is also others who have like an archive of video sound and publish under different licenses and allow you to distribute it in the public domain. So I mentioned, wait, who has the mirror? Yeah, so normally diffraction can be if you like put a mirror on a lamp, but like I give you this one. We were recently visiting archive.org, and it's in San Francisco, their main yeah. This one you can also put in front of your mobile phone to put other colors in front of your camera to have like a wider spectrum. But like archive.org is maybe a forum, you know, a forum as we used to know, something which is between public and private and where things can be discussed. So I think this they use in their big decision-making environments. And the building actually looks the same as the logo, but it was not chosen before. So it used to exist, this difference between public and private. Now it's private to private. The sender is private, the receiver is private, and even the signal is private. And today we are not broadcasting, or are we? No. Internet streaming? No. So we are recording. So recording is actually, and that's very nice because the book is over there. I will also give another one. Here. I can give copy this book, or I can also steal this book, or a stack of books. But in this book of Erik Schrijver, which is also somebody who was, let's say, nourished and bred in the Constant Phase 2 and OSP kitchen, he realized to make a book to inform us about copyright and not only historically, but what is our point of today and how can we understand all of this. And recording is actually one of the bases from which copyright can emerge. And if I record for myself, no problem, and I can show it to you all, but it's a moment when people start to reproduce it or redistribute it, that the copyright comes in action and the law apparatus is activated. And why did I oppose, or we, because I and we and she are in the frequency, when we were VJing, is that all these copyright images, because some of them were reusing, remixing, reconfiguring, resampling, but this was rooted in a Western romantic genius and an author, which was submerged in white male supremacy. And we couldn't identify. Cultural identity is constituted by racist hegemonic practices, and images of barbarianism, conquest, and servitude are over and over reproduced instead of in the distinction with alterity, the savage. So we are, we needed to create a body, also a language, multicolored, diverse, intersectional, critical, transformative, creative, and queer as in anti-normative, without accepting the legal premises of the property regime, the regime, the neoliberal trade regime, which is self-serving and imperialist. We needed to redistribute our language, our visions in the public domain, and license it also, although that's also confirming the property regime, to protect us our critical stance in the current regime. And now we can start to write code of conducts as alternatives or guides to kind communication, like the GPL license our group is now actually doing, because what are alternatives to see that we are allies? And when I opened the first machine, we were experimenting with electricity, I discovered what is power, like from a very technical sense. And in electronic systems, there is something which is called resistance. And resistance is so bizarre, but resistance is not against, you know. It has no polarity. It is not a plus or it is not a minus. It just slows down the system. And so probably in our collective resistance to that property regime and the neoliberal trade regimes, there is a lot of alternatives. And I think in that way, we have to reinforce the thinking that it's civil disobedience and that it is collective. Yeah, and normally I start singing a commercial song now, because then we will have to declare the rights of this recorded TV show if you want to distribute it. But maybe the person who has the forum thing at the moment can say yes or no. Yes. Oh, shit. It doesn't matter what you create if you have no fun. Pretty girl, put down your pen. Come over here, we'll show you how it's done. We can dance, we can drink in the dark, it's all a trick. Yeah, and we replaced, of course, in this commercial song, the I we replaced into a we. And the question of this symposium, and one of them of this session, is copyright the right way to support artists? As artists, I think we have a collective duty to maintain the integrity and the authenticity of cultural expressions and care for the right for all people to participate in the decisions affecting the use of cultural heritage. Intellectual property is a regulatory structure in this information society, and it inhibits the right to access and hence to participate in the creation, innovation, and the production of alternatives. And it's widening the gap between the rich and the poor. Freedom cannot be mere license, and liberties are not libertarian. Freedom carries out responsibility, and free speech may then be a constitutional right, and intellectual property limits somehow the freedom of expression, and it is at the core, and I think you also mentioned it already, infringing our international human rights. It is in the human nature to share, and we need cultural diversity, biodiversity, indigenous seeds, music, herbs, medicine, and with OOO we are in working within and with the future farmers, and we work on the commons of the seeds, like cultural heritage grains, and in the meantime also the commons of the sea, the air, and the frequencies. And commons, actually, it's even still acknowledging the property regime. It articulates a right of use without exclusivity, but it is somehow reinforcing that regime. So in this statement, I would go even more radical and say in the public domain. And not only the content and the semantics, but also in the redistribution and retransmission, we have to consider that all our creations, all our reproductions are using digital technologies which are exploiting our critical natural resource, which is the electromagnetic spectrum, mainly in telecommunication. So you mentioned already the history of radio, and maybe one thing to add upon that, it was a peer-to-peer technology. Everybody was a sender and everybody could be a receiver. So there was through these 100,000 homemade radios, there was like a lot of gossip and music and things shared, as it is our human nature, in that medium. And then the US started to regulate, monopolize, militarize, and commercialize the spectrum. And in OOO, we think we need a cultural disembodiment, and not into the nation and the market, but in that particular signal. And we have a project which is called Pam Pam Pam. And Pam Pam Pam, you say through the marifone to say there is an urgency. It's not life-threatening if you're on a boat. It's not a mayday, but we need to act and do. And I refer to... I refer to, maybe I give this, this is more a handbook. This is what I'm talking about, but there is also a strange paper of notes of somebody, but which I'm, which is, I think. So I refer to the Declaration de Bogota, and that is in 1976. It's a gathering of all equatorial countries and indigenous people on their concern that there are geostationary satellites. So suddenly telecommunication becomes territory, and it's very clear, it's above your head. They wanted to be part of the decision making and the policy. And so many years later, we realize it again, who owns which rights? Who is intellectual and who is the genius, the creator and the master? So we need a disembodied, multiplied voice, and we need to nourish the public domain and also care for the signal. And we don't need to use that signal for mirrored self-expressions on the expense of indigenous people who still have a biodiverse culture. And we are sourcing the data and extract like all possible music, seeds, medicines, and they want to, it's what we project on the indigenous, and we, on who still can project, they represent, or that's the same thing, on who we still can project, that they represent our biodiverse intentional universe. So magical instead of technical reproduction, buy is not buy, to give credit, channel what we provide, we are going to ask you loyalties and study, modify, and implement together within the community. And then there is a quote of Michael Taussig, but it's quite complex. He uses the kuna, which is to reflect on anthropology and how anthropology can be very reductionist to lift culture, because like through an exchange, the kuna people had like in their, they have a special name for it, the their traditional molas. They integrated a Jack Daniels bottle and also the early dog logo of the RCA, because probably they had a gramophone and Jack Daniels with. And no, we don't have to read it as they thought we were gods. They just appropriated in their lift culture. So now we are going to try to do a split sheet. Text is A4 was presented to you, and A4, the one that you got in the beginning. A4 is also a standard, and in copyright and everything, the US has different standards, but this is A4. So if you see the text of this song of Planète Concrète, it's a music project OOO is involved in, and we have to try to make the split sheet. Then we look at the lyrics, and that's actually Shalbhadra Yashari, who sometimes impersonates as Hello Shelley, which is a reference to Hello Kitty, but Hello Shelley is actually suicidal. Yeah, she gave a workshop for character construction during Demons in Shell script, a public performative interface where also one of the next speakers, Femke, was involved with the Make Human Bug Report, which was a critical analysis of the parametric design of a software to create digital virtual characters. So during that project, we also had this... this moment of character building workshop. So the first divine bride playful. That's actually Cosmic Siva, Lonely Pumping Night, Vinkenhart. So it's the results of a workshop which became the lyrics. Tekotsuko Mogami, it's Pubel, it's also me. System Collector Species is number 78, and Flicker Queer Depression is Labette. And I think one of the most important sentences in that, and everybody utters it in a different way, what would you consider the most important sentence, maybe, in the lyrics? Or some people can say some parts.
Not a motherfucking Barbie.
Yeah, that is censored. Afterwards, this was self-censored. This was self-censored because it was very complex to understand that queer is like HIV, and yeah, it's like, where are we in this kind of viral environment? But the most important...
Resonance, rebellion with love.
That's what it...
Fire, layer.
And then at a certain moment, it's, how can I be involved in this? sorry. I forgot to tell that it's very hard with this one, of course, with the split sheets, because so Pink Noise is the track, and then the people who brought out the CD called it also Pink Noise. And then I understand that Pink Noise is actually just a natural phenomenon that probably somebody of QO2 can better explain. It's not white noise where each frequency is as important as the other, but in Pink Noise there was some floating microphone. I look at Henry, but that's maybe too much pressure, because it's very difficult in the octave difference. There is like also a frequency. It's a natural phenomenon. And also, you saw the posters in the beginning. We do believe in radio, and we are supporting with Planet Concrete the program this Saturday, 35 years of Radio Panic. We are in the Cinema Palace across the street. Yeah, that's, yeah. Yeah, but there is something about that.
Yeah,